Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until the breaking of the day. Now when he saw that he did not prevail against him, he touched the socket of his hip, and the socket of Jacob's hip was out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, "Let me go, for the day breaks." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." And he said, "Your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have struggled with God and with men and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, saying, "Tell me your name, I pray." And he said, "Why is it that you ask about my name?" And he blessed him there. And Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, which means face of God. "For I have seen God face to face, and my life is preserved." Now just as he crossed over Peniel, which is another spelling of the same word, means the same thing, the sun rose on him, and he limped on his hip. Therefore, to this day, the children of Israel do not eat the muscle that shrank. Now, this story about Jacob wrestling with this man is extremely obscure. And yet, one gets the impression that it's pretty important because his name is changed to Israel, and the name change usually means something significant. God changes people's names. He changed Abram's name to Abraham and Sarai's name to Sarah. Later, Jesus would change people's names too. God sometimes gives a man another name because a man's name in those days signified something about him, something either about his character or his destiny. Jacob's name had been supplanter because that was his early career. He supplanted his older brother for the inheritance, so that name was descriptive of him. Here his name is changed to Israel. And the actual meaning of the name Israel has been much disputed. Not all scholars give it the same interpretation. The older interpreters interpret it as prince with God, or a prince with God. Some say a struggler with God, or something else like that. It's not entirely clear, which it'd be nice if it was, because it might give us a little more indicator of what this wrestling match was all about. But we have what we have, and no explanation is given. We have a man out of nowhere coming and wrestling with Jacob. Now, some people think this happened in a dream, that he was struggling in his conscience about what he'd done to Esau, his fears and so forth, his subconscious fears were just giving him some troubled dreams. It was like he was, had some kind of a strife going on in his sleep. But the fact that he limped on his hip for the rest of his life indicates this was an actual physical encounter. But why it is that a man would come and wrestle with him like this is not at all explained. Of course, at the end of it, Jacob sees that the man is God. And there's some reason to believe that, of course. The man had the obvious power to cripple him with a touch. And also, by implication, had the authority to give him a different name by which he should go. And so, I mean, these things in themselves suggest that this is not an ordinary man. In Hosea chapter 12, there's reference to this wrestling of Jacob with the man. In chapter 12, it's talking about Jacob in general, his life. And it says in verse 3, Hosea 12:3 says, "He took his brother by the heel in the womb, and in his strength he struggled with God." Now, this is talking about how tenacious Jacob was. Even at his birth, even in the womb, before his body had come out and been delivered through the birth canal, his hands had come out and grabbed the heel of his older twin brother, indicating something. And then it says, "And in his strength he struggled with God." That's a reference to the story we're now looking at. And verse 4 says, "Yes, he struggled with the angel and prevailed. He wept and sought favor from him." Now, this is Hosea's reminiscence of this story. It says he struggled with God, and then it refers to the angel. We have to realize that sometimes the angel of the Lord is a theophany. It's God appearing in the form of an angel or a man. And that's what Hosea indicates this was. This was God that Jacob was struggling with, and he understood that too, because he said, "I've seen God face to face, and my life is preserved." So that much we can sort out. But why he was struggling with God, and why this happened, It's hard to say. You know, the man had been sleepless for 20 years because he'd had to stay awake night and day to watch the sheep. He was an old man, nearly 100 years old at this point, 97, and had just been through a stressful time of fleeing from his uncle for 10 days, apparently fleeing night and day. And then he's had this stressful encounter with his uncle. Now he's got this new stress. His brother, who last he knew wanted to kill him, is coming with 400 men, far more than Jacob could ward off. Jacob has had nothing but stress in his life for a long time, and it's getting worse. But no doubt this wrestling match with God happened to indicate that this wrestling is symbolic. I mean, it really happened. But it was a symbolic of the struggle that Jacob has been going through in his own life with God, that he has been resisting submission to God. Now, you might say, well, we don't read of him resisting submission to God. But remember, he said 20 years earlier, God, if you'll do this and this and this for me, then you'll be my God. That was conditional. And he has not yet surrendered to God. He has not yet said, okay, you are my God. I accept that. God has made promises to him. God has shown him angels that are there to protect him. God has appeared to his adversary Laban and protected him supernaturally that way. Jacob still has not broken down and said, okay, you are my God. Even as recently as the day before when he met with Laban, he referred to God as the fear of his father Isaac in chapter 31, verse 53. That is, God was the one that Isaac fears, that Isaac worships. My dad's God. My father's God, my grandfather's God. But he has not yet referred to God as his own God. And therefore, he is resisting something. There's no reason why he couldn't have submitted to his father's God at a much earlier time. After all, he's seen visions of God. He's received promises from God. He's seen the supernatural intervention of God. The guy's holding out. He's holding out on God. And God is wrestling with him. In fact, all of the stress of the past 20 years, and especially that which has been going on the previous 24 hours or the past 10 days, could be seen as God intensifying the struggle, intensifying the pressure, trying to get him to break down. Now, why wouldn't Jacob break down? Jacob would not break down because he was actually a very strong and resourceful man. I mean, if he could wrestle all night with an angel at age 97 and the angel still not prevail against him, we're talking about a man who had a lot of natural strength as well as his wits. He had lived by his wits. He had gotten the birthright and the blessing by his wits. He had become wealthy in Laban's house, not entirely by his wits, but very much he was very actively involved in increasing the flocks. You know, he saw later it was God that had increased them. But he was a man of resources. He did not see really a need for God in his life, apparently. And many people, that's exactly why they don't become Christians. They just really don't see why they need to. Who needs God? I'm really doing pretty well by myself, thanks. Don't really need to grovel before my Creator. I don't need to humble myself. I'm not really feeling that humble. I feel quite competent. I feel quite adequate. I'm handling it. Life is hard, but I'm still on my feet. My head is bloodied but unbowed. I mean, that's where people often stand in resistance to God, and that's where Jacob was at. Now, this wrestling with God, I think, was almost symbolic of that whole period of struggle, and it was going to come to a head, and he was going to break at this point. The man coming to wrestle with him, the angel, I believe, was to bring this whole, decades-long wrestling match that Jacob had had, resisting God's rule, resisting surrender, refusing to be pinned. This is going to come to an end now, although not easily, because Jacob even wrestled with this man effectively all night long. The angel himself found himself unable to conquer him. Now, think about that for a moment. An angel of the Lord can kill 185,000 Assyrian soldiers in one night. An angel of the Lord has great power. In fact, this angel clearly had plenty of power. He had no problem crippling Jacob just touching him. He could have done that earlier. It's obvious that the inability of the angel or God to break Jacob earlier than this was strictly because God honors the man's free will and is trying to bring the man to the point where he will surrender rather than to simply overwhelm him. And that's how God does work with us. It'd certainly be to our benefit if God would just overwhelm us sometimes and not let us resist. But he honors man's will. God cannot make a man do something in terms of being saintly or surrendered or faithful or love God or any of those things or worship God. God can't make him do that because that has to be a choice that a man will make. And so even God couldn't make Jacob surrender as long as he was stubborn. But God knows how to put the pressure on. And there had been a lot of pressure on Jacob, and it was getting worse. And this night, a full night, Jacob didn't get any sleep. And not only did he not sleep, it's not just that he tossed and turned his bed. He had to exert muscular pressure and energy against the man who was trying to subdue him. And Jacob still persisted, still did not give up, until the man finally said, okay, it's getting near day. I'm going to have to take care of this more quickly. And he touched Jacob in the thigh, and Jacob felt his muscles shrivel, and he realized, okay, it's hopeless. There's no sense continuing to resist. But he still held on. And it says, the man said, let me go, for the day breaks. But he said, I will not let you go unless you bless me. It sounds like Jacob is like in the bargaining position here. I'm not going to let you go until I get what I want from you. But we just read in Hosea that Jacob wept, that he was broken. He was at the end of his tether, and he was weeping and said, I won't let you go unless you bless me. In other words, I cannot go on without your blessing, which is a surrender to God. So the man said to him, what's your name? He said, Jacob. And he said, your name shall no longer be called Jacob but Israel. Now that was the blessing. The blessing is you're now a prince with God. The idea here is that he now belongs to God. He is now God's man. Because you've struggled with God and with men and have prevailed. Notice he didn't prevail until he surrendered. Surrendering is prevailing. And that is really what Jacob's greatest accomplishment was here. Surrendering. He said, I can't go on any further. You have to bless me. I need to be blessed by you. I'm not self-sufficient. I'm not adequate. I'm at the end of my strength. And God sometimes will deliberately bring us to the point where, he hastens the point that we get to that we can't do any more on our own. Crippling Jacob on this occasion, weakening him so he couldn't fight another hour, and he couldn't probably fight another moment without excruciating pain. So he's in tears, and he's crying out, says, okay, uncle, I need to be blessed by you. That's how God breaks the man. And I believe that if you go through the Bible, that you'll find many stories of how strong men, competent men, are simply brought by God's providence to the place where they are broken and helpless. And so also Jacob, who was a strong man in his own nature, had to be brought to the point of weakness. He needed a thorn in his flesh too, which was this shriveled thigh, this permanently crippled condition apparently. And so he limped from that point on.